We'll be on the air in 15 seconds, Mr. Welch.
Yes, I know.
Stand by, everybody.
Starlight, Starbright, First Star, I see you tonight. I wish I may. I wish I might. I wish you get my wish tonight.
Hi, you, Mr. Welch.
Who's that?
Me, Jiminy Cricket.
What's that, Mr. Welch?
I don't know. I guess I was just talking to myself.
Hello, Mr. Welch.
Say, who are you anyway? Where are you?
Well, I'm right here by your side from now on. I'm your conscience.
Look here, aren't you Jiminy Cricket from Walt Disney?
That's right.
Well, what are you doing away from Pinocchio?
Well, he doesn't need me anymore, but you do, Mr. Welch. Somebody's got to keep you out of trouble. We can't have you scaring the whole country again for one thing, and for another...
All right, Mr. Welch.
Well, here we go.
Go away, go away. Good evening. This is Orson Welles, and this is the first of a new radio series brought to you with the compliments of our sponsor, Lady Esther. Tonight it's our plan...
Now, don't do too much talking.
We of the Mercury Theater...
Get on with the show.
Ladies and gentlemen, I apologize for this interruption.
Do something about it. I'm sitting right here on your shoulder. No, no, Mr. Welles. On the other one. Hey, you're doing fine. Just keep it brief and get on with it.
All right, all right. Well, let's start off with a short story by Saki called Sredni Vashtar. Conradin was 10 years old, and the doctor said he wouldn't live another 5 years.
I understand perfectly, Doctor. And you may be sure, as the child's guardian, that I shall see that Conradin does nothing that is not beneficial to his health.
Conradin hated his guardian.
Conradin? How many times have I told you not to walk near the pool? Conradin? You are not to pick the roses. Conradin, it's time for you to come in for your syrup.
And so passed year after year. One of these days, Conradin supposed the doctor would be proved right and he would die. But meanwhile, there was an oasis in the desert of his loneliness and boredom. This was a diffused tool shed in a forgotten corner of the lower garden. There, Conradin found a haven. He peopled it with ghosts, with phantoms from his books and from his dreams. And the tool shed boasted two inmates of flesh and blood. In one corner lived a chicken, a ragged, plumaged old hen, on which the boy lavished an affection that had scarcely another outlet. And further back in the gloom stood a large hutch fronted with iron bars. This was the abode of a very large polecat ferret, which a friendly butcher boy had once smuggled into in cage and all. Conradin was dreadfully afraid of the light, evil, sharp-fanged beast, but it was his most treasured possession. The very presence of so dangerous an animal in the tool shed was a secret and fearful joy to be kept scrupulously from the knowledge of the woman, as he privately dubbed his guardian. And one day, out of heaven knows what material, he spun the beast a wonderful name. Sredni Vashtar. Sredni Vashtar, the great ferret. From that moment, it grew into a god and a religion. Every Thursday, in the dim and musty silence of the tool shed, he worshipped with mystic and elaborate ceremonial before the wooden hutch. And there were great festivals. On one occasion, when his guardian, Mrs. de Rupp, suffered from a painful toothache for 3 days, Conradin kept up the festival during her entire illness and almost persuaded himself that Sredni Vashtar was personally responsible for the toothache.
What on earth do you suppose the child does in that old tool shed, Matilda?
I'm sure, ma'am, I don't know. Maybe it's the hen.
The hen?
Yes, ma'am. It took up living in the shed about 2 years ago. Master Conradin's taken a liking to it, ma'am.
Oh, indeed. Well, we shall look into that. It's not good for him to be puttering about there in all weathers. You go down and get it, Matilda, and get rid of it.
Oh, but ma'am, my...
You will do as I say.
But ma'am, I don't much like going into that shed. There's something peculiar about it.
Nonsense. Merely open the door and the hen will come out. They always do. You won't need to go in at all.
Very well, ma'am. Just as you say.
Oh, and Matilda... In case Master Conradin's quite upset, we'd better have toast for tea. He's very fond of toast. Of course, it's bad for him, but just this once.
And maybe a little preserve.
The toast will be quite sufficient, Matilda.
And then at tea the next day, she told him.
It isn't good for you, Conradin, to brood about in that musty tool shed. So I was forced to get rid of the hen.
You what?
I got rid of the hen. Matilda caught it this morning and sold it to the butcher.
Oh.
Well? Well? Aren't you going to say something?
What is there to say?
And you're not eating your toast?
No.
I thought you particularly liked toast.
I like it sometimes.
And in the shed that evening, there was an innovation in the worship of the hutch god. Conradin had been wont to chant his praises. Now he asked a boon.
Do one thing for me, Sredni Vashtar.
That one thing was not said. dusk of the tool shed, Conradin's bitter litany went up.
Do one thing for me, Shredney Vashtar. Do one thing for me.
Mrs. DeRock noticed that the visits to the shed did not cease.
Conradin, what else are you keeping in that hut? Answer me, Conradin. Very well. I shall find out for myself. I believe it's guinea pigs. I'll have them all cleared out at once. No, on the contrary, I shall do it myself. Then I shall be quite certain that it's done.
And the woman immediately marched down to the shed to find out what she could find. It was a cold afternoon, and Conradin had been told to keep to the house. But from the furthest window of the dining room, he could just see the door to the tool shed. He saw the woman enter, and he knew that soon she would come out with that first smile on her face that he loathed so much. And in an hour, the gardener would carry away his wonderful garden. She would have triumphed again.
Shredney Vashtar went forth. The spots were red spots. And his teeth were white. His enemies called for peace. But he brought them death. Shredney Vashtar, the beautiful.
Then suddenly he stopped his chanting and drew closer to the window. The door of the shed still stood ajar, and the minutes were slipping by. Then Matilda came in to lay the table for tea, and still Conradin stood and waited.
Redney Vashtar went forth. His thoughts were red thoughts, and his teeth were white.
And then the boy stopped. Brought from the doorway of the shed came a long, low, yellow and brown beast, with eyes blinking at the waning light, and dark, wet stains around the fur of its jaws and throat. He made his way across the garden and disappeared into the shrubbery.
Tea is ready, Master Conradin. Where's the mistress?
She went down to the shed some time ago.
I shall call her. You better wait for your tea till I fetch her.
But no sooner had she left the room than Conradin calmly buttered a piece of toast with much butter and began to eat it with slow enjoyment. And while they debated the matter among themselves, Conradin buttered himself another piece of toast. Ladies and gentlemen, we started off our first show of this new series for Lady Esther with Saki's eeriest little legend, Shredney Vashtar. And for this, we were lucky enough to be able to star Blanche Yorker in the role of Mrs. DeRupp, a name so eminent needs nothing added to it. And Conradin was Conrad Binion. And Matilda was Miss Brenda Forbes, who's a Mercury actress from way back and will continue to be as long as we have anything to do about it. Here we are at the end of our first broadcast for Lady Esther. Believe me, a grand sponsor. I don't have to tell you how good Lady Esther face powder and Lady Esther face cream is.
R.
Thanks, Jiminy. Ladies and gentlemen, we do hope you're going to like our program. And we hope you'll let us come to your home to entertain you next week at the same time. Till then, speaking for Lady Esther and everybody in the Mercury Theater, I remain, as always, obedient to yours.
And me too, Jiminy Cricket. From now on, I remain obediently his.